Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to week 4 of Progress TV. Here's our number. If you have any clips of you doing any of the activities, send them in. We'll show them all in our kids' highlights reel on Wednesday. Darla away there, son, I'm done. Dia gwit, agus fall the road gudi ma yomra stadar, agus ma yomra kiol. My room of music and my room of study. We call it the den. So, we have a great show for you today. First up, we've got Arts and Craft with Mr. Corbett. He made a t-shirt there 2 weeks ago. Who knows what he's going to do this week? We're off to Mr. Tyrrell for some STEM. Then, we have the cooking corner. I hope she's making some nice buns. That's Miss Cahill from the junior school. A nature walk, Mr. Ryan adventures outside his house and teaches us all about his surrounding areas. Then, Mr. Moroney out the country is going to teach us some mental maths. A new segment we have, a brand new segment. Then, the Power Hour. We're over to the junior school for the Power Hour, where she makes a snakes and ladders board. Who will win? Then, the days of the week, which is super duper, and that is Miss Waters, a good friend of mine. She's going to teach us all about the days of the week. Then, farm life. Mr. Bell and the farm life. What's he going to show us? And to finish us off, we have a very good treat, an act of home dance with Miss Kennedy and her teaching partners. Or maybe just Miss Kennedy. Who knows? Take it away, Mr. Corbett and the Arts and Crafts.
Hi guys, I hope you got on all right with the t-shirt print craft that we did last week. This week we're going to move towards a more art-based lesson and focus on colour. As with all the lessons we've done so far, we're going to try and use materials that you would have at home. And a lot of this stuff is equipment you might use at school. If there's anything you don't have, don't worry. You should be able to find some pretty easy substitutes around the house. Okay. That's more than enough of me talking for this lesson. Let's begin.
Okay, here are our materials for today's lesson. We have a poly pocket or plastic pocket that we use to keep sheets. We're going to use some non-stick markers. Here I have highlighters and that's perfect too. We're also going to need a scissors for cutting, obviously. We'll need some glue stick or some Pritt stick. We'll also need a water dropper, but if you don't have one of those, that's okay. You can use a glass of water and a steady hand. Anything that can let little drops of water fall. We'll also need an A4 sheet of paper, and if you have it, some black card paper. To begin, we get our highlighters and we start colouring in one side of our poly pocket. Use as many colours as possible and colour it in patches. Create a pattern if you want, but you can also be as messy as you need be. Just make sure that as much of the poly pocket is covered in as possible. The more colour, the better. Once that's done, get your A4 sheet and your water dropper. Drop little water droplets all over the sheet. Be generous with this. The more water, the better for this activity. Spread them out evenly across the page. Now we're going to get our poly pocket sheet and place it down over our A4 paper. Flatten it out and allow the water to soak up. Reveal it. That's not too bad for a first attempt, but it could be better. So we turn over our poly pocket sheet and colour in the opposite side, repeating what we've just done. Use another pattern with lots of different colours again, leaving no blank spaces. When the A4 sheet is dried, use your water dropper to add drops to the sheet again, placing as many as possible over the blank spaces on the sheet. Let's go, take two. We place our poly pocket down on our A4 sheet. Remember, it's the opposite side now. and we flatten it out, allowing the water to soak in with the marker paint. Now for the big reveal. As you can see, it's not always the smoothest movement, but there we go. That's not too bad. That's a big improvement. I'm happier with that. For our next step, we're going to get a cutout. This can be from a magazine or from an internet printout, or it can even be from a drawing you do yourself. And I want you to trace the outline of it onto a black card. Once you have that outline traced, I want you to cut it out using the scissors. As you can see here, I've used Spider-Man. And in fairness, he turned out pretty well. We're now going to use our glue stick or our Pritt stick to attach Spider-Man to our colorful drawing. There he is, and he's on. Now, if you have more black card paper, you can use it as a background to your painting. Again, we're going to use our Pritt stick and our glue stick to stick it on. And I'll tell you what, it doesn't look too bad.
Okay guys, I hope you enjoyed that activity. I actually had good fun doing it, even though it took me a bit of time and it wasn't the neatest activity I've ever done. But to be honest, I'm pretty happy with Spider-Man and his cool, colorful background. I've no doubt though, you guys can do it a lot better than me. So I look forward to seeing your entries on WhatsApp or on our email. Until next time, see you later.
Mr. Corbett, I'm a massive Spider-Man fan. Not too sure if Batman or Spider-Man is my favorite, but the fact that you did a silhouette of Spider-Man, he might just be winning that battle. Next up, we're going to use silhouette in our literacy sentence, and also du soid an muntor dahana sem kyakshin. The teacher used colors for that. Can you put that into an Irish sentence and that into an English sentence? Now we're off to Mr. Tyrrell. Mr. Tyrrell is going to do a STEM project where he's going to make something super cool. Can you guess what it is? Take it away, Mr. Tyrrell.
Thank you, Mr. Reed. Welcome back, boys and girls, to another week of Progress TV. I have another STEM challenge for you this week, but rather than tell you about it, I think I'd rather show you. Can you figure out what's going on? Let's go and have a look. So, boys and girls, this is our project for this week. It is a basic catapult, and one really important thing about it is that it is safe. Another great thing is that the resources that you need, you should have most of those at home. If you need to collect a few, you can over the next few days. But I love it, it's lots of fun. And better still, it doesn't take long to make. So come with me and I'll show you how.
So the resources that you will need, some lollipop sticks, some elastic bands, blue tack or double-sided tape, a bottle cap and a die. Try to ensure that your elastic bands are secured tightly around each end. Next we'll put one lollipop stick either side and again we'll secure tightly around one end. Next, we will wrap one elastic band diagonally across the center of our catapult and again repeat on the other side. Finally, we will wrap one elastic band at the top of our catapult to ensure that everything stays in place. Now we're ready to stick our bottle cap, which acts as the bucket, to the top of the catapult. Now we're ready to test it out and see if it works.
So, there you have it. While there was some basic engineering involved in the construction of our catapult, some of you, especially our younger viewers, might need a small bit of assistance or help with some parts. What I want to show you now is some ways that you can actually use your catapult to make your learning more fun and enjoyable. For those of you that were watching really closely at the beginning of my video, you might have noticed that my target was a big board or a mat. And even if you don't have one of those, you can make your own out of paper, card, cardboard, or whatever else you have. Here are some ideas that I came up with that you might find useful. Before I sign off, just a quick reminder, boys and girls, that we love to see your videos coming in to us, your ideas, your creations, your inventions, and we love to share them with others. So, until next time, happy engineering, and see you then.
Mr. Tyrrell, thanks a million. I used to make loads of catapults when I was a youngster, like many of you. So that's the word I want you to put into a sentence for literacy. Next up, we have the Irish word, cliffa. So, croig sé catapult, agus físeann an cliffa a Imert. He was able to play a game. Can you use that to put into a sentence? Cooking corner from the junior school. What do you have for us, Miss Cahill? It smells great.
Hi everyone from Holy Family Junior and Senior Schools, Mrs. Cahill here. I hope you're all feeling well and safe and happy at home. And today I'm going to show you how to make some really easy and delicious cookies because I think you all deserve a treat. For this recipe you just need four ingredients and I'm going to show you what you need now. You're going to need some oats, some plain flour, some caster sugar and some butter. I've already weighed out all of my ingredients, so now I'm just going to put them all together in the mixer and mix them together. So I'll put in the oats first. Now if you don't have a mixer, that's okay. You can just mix everything together with your wooden spoon. Sugar. Now the last thing that we're going to put in is a butter. I'm just going to turn it on low first of all for a couple of minutes and then I'll increase the speed and we'll mix it for a couple of minutes. So I mixed this in the mixer for a couple of minutes until it turned to be nice and sticky and I just brought it together in a ball with my spatula. So now I'm going to put it onto my board. I've put a little bit of flour down so that it won't stick. So pop it out and you can sprinkle another little bit of flour on the top because it's quite sticky and you don't want it to stick to the table or to your mat. And keep another little bit of flour. Now I have a rolling pin to roll it out, but if you don't have a rolling pin, it doesn't matter. You can just smooth it out like this with your hand. If you are smoothing it with your hand, make sure just to keep turning it a little bit so that it doesn't stick. Another little bit of flour. And off we go. Now you're going to make nice, thick cookies. Because you'd like to have a big treat. So roll it out like this. And let's see, does that look good? I think that looks good. Put another little bit on the top. Now, I'm going to use this cutter. With this cutter, I can make about 25 cookies. If you don't have this shape, you can make a heart or a star or a flower shape. And if you don't have any cutter at home, you could use this tin. That's about the same size as I have. So I'll work with this first. I'm going to put a little bit of flour on the bottom of my cutter. Just going to put it in here. Twist it around a little bit. Slide it off the mat. And put it straight onto my baking tray. Now let's try it with the tin. So we're going to just put it down at that, turn it around. See the lovely shape it makes? You can just get a normal knife from your cutlery drawer and cut gently round. And you have a perfect cookie shape. So we'll take that one out. We'll pop that one over here beside this one. Leave a little bit of space on the tray because they will spread a little bit. Now before I put my dough onto the mat, I turn my oven on to 180 degrees. We'll do one more with the cutter. Move that out of the way. In the end, you will be mixing all that, gathering all that extra dough up into another ball and rolling it out again to make as many cookies as you can. So we'll fill up the tray and then we'll be ready for baking. As you can see, I have 9 cookies ready on my tray and I have my dough ready to cut out some more. So my oven is ready. It's 180 degrees. It's nice and warm. I'm going to put these cookies in. First, I'm going to put on my oven gloves and then I'm going to put them in. You'll get your mom or dad to help you putting these into the oven and taking them out of the oven because it's quite hot. So in they go. And we're going to cook those for 15 or 20 minutes. You'll know when you see them, they'll go to be a nice golden brown colour. So the cookies have been in the oven now for 20 minutes. They're a lovely golden light colour and I'm going to take them out because they're ready. Now I'm going to move them up to this wire tray to help them cool. They're a bit hot and they're a little bit soft, so be careful when you're transferring them over. So there you go, some delicious oat shortbread cookies made in 20 minutes with only 4 ingredients, and they are just delicious. So I really hope you'll try to make them, and I really hope we'll see you back in Holy Family really soon. Bye, take care.
Miss Cahill and the Cooking Corner, thanks a million. I can smell those lovely cookies from here. Now, the English word we've taken from that is oven. Please put it into a sentence, send it into us. And the Irish word is caoca. De me caoca millish are rare. I ate a sweet cake last night. Fact. Now we're over to Mr. Ryan and his nature walk, where he explores the outdoors. Take it away, Mr. Ryan.
Hello boys and girls. Looking at this piece of land behind me here, you might think there's nothing too interesting to see there. But sometimes nature can hold some surprises. Let's go and take a look.
So, let's go in and see what we can find. Okay, well straight away I can see loads of these trees. These are willow trees. And they are known as sallies in the country because in the old days, when everyone spoke Irish, they called them
sal.
Yeah, is the Irish word for willow. And these are willow trees. In fact, it's called the pussy willow or the goat's willow. Oh, there's a surprise. Now that would make a perfect catapult. When I was a young fella now, I would have loved to find that. There's my perfect catapult. All I have to do is cut that there and make a perfect catapult. Now, I think just around this corner, you might find something interesting. We have loads of the willow around here, and I'm going to take some of that back with me to my house because I need it for something. So, this is a goat willow tree, and it's a bit further along than the others in that it has its catkins fully out. These are the flowers called the catkins. And quite unusual. You can see the yellow pollen on top of them there. And this particular tree is covered in all these lovely catkins. Maybe that's why they call it the pussy willow as well, because it's a bit like a furry cat's tail, maybe.
Welcome back, boys and girls. Now, a few minutes ago, I was down in the field and I showed you the willow tree, the goat willow tree. And you might remember I said that the branches are very supple. That means they're very easy to bend. So here's one of the branches I collected when I was down there a few minutes ago, and you can see how easy it is to bend. It bends past 90 degrees without breaking. Okay, so because of that feature, the willow branches were often used to make baskets in the old days, and in fact even today people still make willow baskets. So I've got one here that I started. I'm trying to make one. It's my first time, so it's still a work in progress. Okay, now I've used these willow sticks. These are called stakes at the side. Okay, and I've bent them to make the supports at the side. And the base, I've already woven the base with these small little willow branches. They're called weavers. So these are the small ones. Okay, and the base is actually called the slat. Now, I have one more stake to add here into my into the side of my basket. And here's my willow stick. It's stronger than the small branches. These are called weavers. The small ones are weavers, and these are the stakes. So I'm going to try and bend this so that I can use it on the side. So if you bend it carefully until it's just about to break. Now, I'm going to stick it in here. And we'll put it in there, I think. Okay, so we shove it in. In fact, I need to point it. Top of it needs to be pointed so that I can shove it into the slat at the bottom. I've got a nice point on that now. Got a nice bend on it. And we'll put it in here, like so. Shove it well in. And then bend it up here. And we can tie it off with some string just to make sure that it doesn't fall off. So that's the sides of it done. I'll just keep that temporarily there. Okay. Now, I'm going to start on the sides of the basket now. So I need some weavers. So I strip the branches off, or the little leaves, I mean. Strip the leaves off like that. So they come off very easily. Pinch the top off. That's one. That's one weaver stick. And we get another one here. So these baskets were made in the old days to carry things around. They're quite strong when they're made. The basket won't be this big. I'll go to about there, and then we'll cut off the tops. Okay? So the way you make it is, you get two weaver sticks like that, put them together. Start at the bottom. Now, one weaver stick goes on one side. Okay, just put that in a little bit further. And the other one, so one goes under, one goes over. You cross them. So I don't know if you can see that. You cross the sticks like that. So again, one goes under, one goes over. Keep going like that. One goes under, one goes over. And when you come to the end of your weaver stick, get another two. And I have some here that I've stripped. Put the two of them together. Turn your basket slightly sideways. Start the next row. Shove them in like that. And again, sometimes it can be a bit tricky to get them in. A bit of practice. A lot of things in life. Now, and again, start off as before. One under, one over. So, a long time ago, before people had, you know, plastic and other materials to make newer baskets, they used to make baskets like this, and they would have a handle on the top. They're quite strong, and they last for quite a long time. And it's quite a nice thing to make. So hopefully sometime soon, I'll show you how to make one, how to weave a basket using paper. Okay, that's it for the willow basket weaving, and take care, we'll see you again soon. Bye bye.
Mr. Ryan, thanks a million. Your nature walk was unbelievable. The English word we've taken from that is explore, and the Irish word is blahana. Conicamer, blahana, ildata, inakot. Now, over to our mental maths guru. Take it away, Mr. Moroney. Get out a pen and paper. This'll be tricky.
We'll have our 4th, 5th and 6th class maths challenge. Again, we'll have 10 questions. So if you have a pencil or a pen and a piece of paper, we'll begin. The answers will be on next week's Progress TV. Question 1. Which number is closest to 500? 491 or 525? Question 2. What is 735 plus 1,200? 735 plus 1,200. Question 3. Liam hires a bike. He has to return it by 3 p.m. The time is 2:20. How many minutes does he have before the bike has to be returned? Question 4. Draw a square on a piece of paper. Tell me, can you find 4 lines of symmetry in it? Question 5 is one of our tables. What is 12 multiplied by 11? Question 6. Add 144 centimeters plus 144 centimeters. And I want you to write your answers in meters and centimeters. So supposing your answer is 556 centimeters, you write your answer as 5 meters and 56 centimeters. Question 7. How many years are there in 60 months? How many years are there in 60 months? Again, we know that there are 12 months in a year.
Question 8.
How many days are there in 72 hours? Again, we all know there's 24 hours in a day. Question 9. How many weeks are there in 84 days? And we all know that there are 7 days in a week. Our final question, question 10. Simon has 30 raffle tickets. And he sells them all and makes 18 euro. How much did he charge per ticket?
Mr. Moroney, thank you so much. You've taught us about lines of symmetry and some wonderful questions there. Can you get all the answers and send them right in? That's the English word. Put it into a sentence. And the Irish word is fibe, hug, and muntor, fibana, doing. He gave us lots of challenges and lots of tasks. Next up, we're over to Miss Power from the junior school, where she creates a wonderful game of snakes and ladders, one of my favorite games when I was a youngster. Take it away, Miss Power.
Hi guys, how are you? I just thought I'd make a little video for you to show you how to make a snakes and ladders board at home. What you need is a piece of paper. This is a rectangular piece of paper. I'm going to make it into a square. So you've got your rectangle, you've got your 2 long sides and your 2 short sides. You fold it over and you make a crease. You've got an extra piece here at the side. You cut that off, guys. And you're left with a square. Put it down. You take a colour. You also need a ruler. And you need to draw some lines. Because if you remember at school, when we play snakes and ladders, our board is full of numbers. So we're going to make some lines first. We're going to do 9 lines across. You can count with me, okay? 1 2 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. And you turn it around and you do 9 lines across again. You see it in there, nice and close. You If you remember your snakes and ladders board, you always start down in this corner with number one. So I'm going to go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. So we start at the bottom and we work our way up to the top. First line starts at 1 and ends at 10. When you get to 10, this is the tricky bit. You go from 10, you go straight up, 11, 12, you're going back, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20. You go up again, and you keep going back. Then you go up and across, up and back, up and across, up and back, or you get right up to 100. Now, I made one earlier. As you can see, it started number one down the bottom and it ended at number 100 at the top. Because it's a snakes and ladders board, you can see I've drawn in the snakes and I've drawn in the ladders. I've made one really, really long snake, as you can see, because there's always a really long snake on a snakes and ladders board. That's the one everybody wants to try and avoid. I have no dice and I have no counters, so I need to make a dice and I need to make counters. So to write out the numbers on the dice. So the numbers on the dice are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And then I cut them into little pieces. So there's a 6, and so on. All the numbers are here. And this is going to be your dice. That gives me to shuffle around. Now, I have no counters, so I get a piece of paper. I cut out a little rectangle and another rectangle. One purple, one blue. I'm going to start the game. So I'm going to be purple and I'm going to shuffle up the numbers, my dice, and I'm going to pick this one. And I've got 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. Then whoever I'm playing with, they're on blue. I put this back in again, shuffle up the dice. And it's blue's turn, and they've got a, that's right, they've got a 3. Back in and count 1, 2, 3. And you keep going. Whoever gets to 100 first is the winner. You're doing a little bit of counting, which is brilliant for your maths. You're also doing a little bit of art, a little bit of craft. Okay, guys, have fun. Stay safe. Until the next time. Bye, guys.
Miss Power, thank you so much. What a wonderful board game you've created. So I'm challenging you, all the children from the junior school and the senior school, to make that board game of snakes and ladders and to send us in some pictures. The English word we want you to put into a sentence is crease, and the Irish word is cairnog, and that's a square. Try and put them into a sentence for us and send them in also. Next up, Miss Waters, the lovely Miss Waters, is going to teach us all about the days of the week. Miss Waters, take it away.
Progress. Good morning, everybody. Hope everybody is well today. I'm just going to put the soap in the green dresser after washing my hands to keep safe during COVID-19. But before we do that, we're going to say our rhyme to see if our dresser will open, just like the rhyme distills your practices with us at assembly. Let's open the green dresser doors and let's have a look inside. If you have worked hard enough, washing your hands and staying safe with your family, we might just find some fun things inside. And it opens straight away. So we're doing a writing activity today. I'm going to take my notebook and I'm going to take my pens and my markers and my pencils. So on the laptop, just have opened up our days of the week, and that's our writing activity today. So I'm going to take my marker and I'm going to write a list. So I'm going to start at the left and write number one, and I'm going to write Sunday. And we know the days of the week start with a capital letter. Sunday.
leave a space, number two, Monday, capital M. We know we have a capital letter at the start of a sentence. The days of the week, the name of a person or a place, the months of the year. So I'm writing a list, Sunday, Monday, Tuesday. After Tuesday, we have Wednesday. Fifth day of the week, Thursday. Sixth day of the week, Friday. On the seventh day of the week, Saturday. Just checking my numbers, putting in my dot. So I have Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday. There are 7 days in the week.
Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday. 7 days are in a week. I like to sing them quiet. Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday. 7 days are in a week. I like to sing them loud. Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, clap them out. Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday. 7 days are in a week.
Miss Waters, thanks a million for teaching us all about the days of the week. Do you know the days of the week in Irish or Osceola? Write them down and send them in if you know. Challenge yourself. Have a think about it there. The word we've taken from that lesson is capital. Also, we've taken capital because the days of the week take a capital letter, and also so do the months. They take a capital letter, but the seasons don't. So now, as summer has just started, if you're ever using summer in a sentence, forget about the capital letter. It takes a little small letter. The Irish word is Seachtain, and recently we had Seachtain na Gaeilge, Irish week in school, so can you put that into a sentence? Next up, we're off to Mr. Bell, one of my favourite segments from the farm. What's going in the farm?
Progress. On our farm, we have three different types of fields. Field we're in at the moment is a very low-lying field. As you can see, there are rushes growing in it. And that's a sign that it sometimes gets very wet. In the winter time, it can even be underwater. Where I'm standing was actually under 20 centimetres of water just a few months ago. Thankfully, now it's really well dried out, lovely grass growing here, and we have the sheep and the cattle down grazing here in these fields. In County Clare, refer to this type of land as Corcus. So yesterday was a really big day for the pet lambs or the bottle fed lambs. Yesterday was our first day in the bigger field with all the rest of the sheep. Up to yesterday they were in their own little paddock beside the house and they were inside in the shed every night. So last night was their first night outside, and as you can see they're doing very well. I've already seen the cows and calves this morning, so I know they're all okay. But as we're passing their paddock, I might as well have a little look, just double check. They all seem very content. You can see a number of them chewing the cud. Happy? Let's move on. So this is our second field type. This is higher up than the carcasses, so it never floods during the winter time. Now, we call this type of land limestone land. You can see we've got lots of trees up the middle of the field and some rocky outcrops and just some uneven land. So this is just for grazing only. Now, I mentioned the last day that some of our fields have some historical features. Right now, I'm standing in what was somebody's house many, many years ago. Look all the way around here. We've got the remains of the old walls. And we think this house probably dated back to before the famine times. If we look over here, we've got other ridges. They used to be stone walls years and years ago. So that was probably the little field for the animals near the house. So we think that old ruin is from pre-famine times, making it maybe 200 years old. Now, in this field, we've got a feature that's much, much older. If I walk up this embankment here, I'm onto a nice platform. You can see it's kind of circular in shape, and it's clear, there are no trees up the middle of it. This is a ring fort. Some people would refer to it as a fairy fort. There are many of these dotted around Ireland, and I'm very proud to say that we have one here on our farm. So this could be thousands of years old, and this was actually a dwelling. Think of an enclosure, maybe stone walls around the perimeter, maybe a timber fence. This would have been a hive of activity. Plenty of little houses in here, and maybe the animals were brought in at night time for safety, and the gate closed behind them. It's really exciting to think what this must have been like many years ago. And here, close to the centre, we've got a really interesting feature. It's a large, flat rock. And I just think, since this platform is man-made, I just think it's no accident that this is here. I definitely think it had some purpose in the past. Was it a fireplace? Was it a place where a craftsman plied his trade? Who knows? And finally, this is our third field type. So the type of soil that's here, it's limestone soil again, making it the same as the previous grazing fields. However, it's very different. There are no trees up the middle of the field, even though there are plenty around the edge. And there are no rocky outcrops. It's a nice, smooth, level field, which makes this type of field really convenient for driving our tractor in. We can cut the grass here with the mower, and we know it's safe. We're not going to damage it, hitting it off anything. So this is where we cut our silage and we make our bales in this field. So in a few weeks' time, hopefully I'll be able to show you that.
Mr. Bell, thank you so much for inviting all of us into your farm. I do love those clips. The English word we took was ring fort. History lesson, check out what a ring fort is, draw a picture, and write a sentence using this word underneath your picture. Send it in, and we'll show it on our children's highlights reel next Thursday. The Irish word is porkina, fields, and didn't we learn a lot about the fields right there? Now, just before we end, I want to show you the number we have for Progress TV. Another wonderful episode comes to a conclusion, so send in your clips and check them out next Thursday. Now, what a treat we have. Haven't seen this yet. It's an active home dance from all the teachers in third class. They told me the English word is blinding. Blinding lights. And they're doing a dowsa. What does dowsa mean? Enjoy, slán, and see you next week.
Of Mahagut Mr. Eat. So for this week's active home challenge, I decided to get some feedback from the pupils in third class on seesaw, and they asked to see could we include a dance activity in this week's episode of Progress TV. Now, dance isn't one of my strong points, so I decided to seek some help from my colleagues and my friends in third class, Miss Kennedy, Miss Fahan, and Mr. Tyrrell. To see would they join in with me, and thankfully they agreed. So the challenge we're setting for the pupils in the junior and the senior schools is to see, can you on your own or with your families do a better job than us? So we'd love to see how you got on. Send your challenges to the WhatsApp number, and now is your opportunity to see how we did.